Hi there, and welcome to Mr. Carlson's lab. So do you work on or troubleshoot audio amplifiers, hi-fi amplifiers or guitar amplifiers? Do you work on receivers, say troubleshooting RF and IF, maybe oscillator circuits? If you do, have I got the thing for you. So in a previous episode, I developed an RF probe that helped me find a crackly component inside of a receiver. I also used a contact style RF probe, nothing really too special. I'll show you how to build both of those things. But here's the thing. In the last little while, I've been developing an extremely sensitive audio and RF probe that's very, very useful for working on circuits to find noise, find missing signals. You can detect whether IF sections are working, whether oscillators are working, if you have noisy resistors or capacitors, without even attaching the thing into the circuit, just basically by sweeping through the circuit. Extremely sensitive device. And I'm going to share that with you in this episode. So I'll share the schematics. I'll show you exactly how to build something like this, and I'll show you how to use it. So let's get started. These are the two probes that I used in that last Hammarlund video in order to troubleshoot that crackly component. So this probe here is a contact style probe, really nothing too incredibly special inside, pretty standard build. I use a little bit, I guess you could say a more robust diode in here so that this thing can deal with higher RF voltages and things like that. So I'll show you this here in just a moment. Really handy tool to have if you're, you know, looking to make direct contact to connections inside of a receiver or something like that. Just an old Heathkit probe shell that I'm using here. Really handy probe shells. So I have a couple of these things. So I'll show you the schematic for this one here in just a moment. And this is that non-contact style probe that I was using. Quite a bit more sensitive than the other probe. And designed to sniff around in a receiver with an active IF chain or an active RF area inside. So basically, this is designed to be around, you know, a relatively large signal inside a chassis of a receiver. So this can, you know, pick up any kind of noise in the IF chain or something like that. And we'll take a look at the schematic for this here in just a moment as well. So this is kind of a neat little build, very simple, hardly anything inside this thing, just like the other probe, just, you know, a little bit more sensitive. And the other probe that I'm going to put together, of course, is, you know, incredibly more sensitive than these things are. So that's a completely separate thing altogether. So I'll grab the schematics here. Just move over here. Pop these down here. So this is the RF probe for the signal tracer. So this one here, and this is the non-contact style RF probe. And the other one is down the list here somewhere. And somewhere in there. So I'll just move this over here. Get this out of the way. So we'll take a look at the contact style probe first here. So really, nothing too incredibly special. That's basically all it is three components inside that probe. So this 0.005 microfarad capacitor just attaches to the tip. I'm using a 1N459 diode. It's a little bit different. It's a black colored diode with color bands on it, and it's really robust. It's how would you say, hard to destroy under, you know, high RF situations. So that's the reason that I'm using this diode, and it still works very, very well to detect, as you heard in the last video. What I'm going to do at the end of the video is I'll link that particular section of the troubleshooting in that Hammarlund HQ140X receiver below, so you can click on the link and it'll take you right to the troubleshooting section if you're interested in seeing how these two probes work. So a 4.7 meg resistor of your choice, and that just really runs out to the coax, and that's what's in this probe here. Nothing too special. That's pretty much it. So that's that probe. Let's get that out of the way. And this one here is the non-contact probe that you saw. Still very simple. You almost twist these components together inside of the probe shell. So it's very important to have a shielded probe shell. If you want to insulate it to keep yourself safe, you can do that as well. That's completely up to you. But the probe shell needs to be shielded. If it's not shielded, you're going to be picking up a lot of noise from your hand holding it and things like that. So it has to have some form of metal shielding inside of an insulated case. Again, if you're uncomfortable with handling a metal probe shell, like the like this one here is a metal probe shell here, and so is the other Heathkit one. They're all a metal probe shell. You can insulate it from your hand and do that. So, you know, if you're working in high voltage circuits, that's, you know, pretty advisable. So if you're going to be using any probe with a metal shell on it, take care, because if you come across the wrong part, you're in for a surprise. So you're using any of these things, you're doing so at your own risk. Take care. So the components that I'm using are just 1N5711 Schottky diodes, and they work very, very well. There's an 8.2 meg resistor to ground inside the probe shell, and this just runs out to the coax again. And this here is that non-contact style RF probe. So this one here is designed to just kind of sweep around in an active RF circuit. You don't want to make any contact with this, even with an isolation capacitor here. You don't want to make any contact into an IF chain that's active in a receiver, or you'll very quickly destroy these 1N5711s. They're extremely sensitive to anything like that. And again, even if you have a blocking capacitor in here, if you say have a 20 picofarad blocking capacitor on this and you touch the plate lead of the last IF stage in a Hammarlund, you'll completely destroy these diodes. Again, too sensitive for that, so it has to be non-contact. And that's the reason that I'm using this shielding over this, so that I can't really go bumping anything. And again, in that video, you can see how sensitive this is. I just lean it up against the noisy component and it basically hears it. Now again, the trick with this whole thing is it's in an active IF chain. So, I would classify this not as a super sensitive probe, but, medium sensitivity, I guess you could say. So those are these two probes. So what I'm going to do is go grab the schematic for the other probe, and we'll discuss the schematic and we'll get into the build of the incredibly sensitive RF and audio probe. All right, I finally managed to find the file folder. It was in a completely separate stack of files, so I think I misplaced this somewhere along the ways. I started building this in quite a while back. I'll get into that story here in just a minute. So the whole idea of this super sensitive RF and AF probe is really just to improve upon the design of this probe that you saw in the Hammarlund HQ140X video. Now don't get me wrong, it's an absolutely great probe to use with a signal tracer that's already built, like an ICO, Heathkit, or some sort of night kit signal tracer. No problems whatsoever. For a non-active probe, this is a really highly sensitive probe. But when you compare this probe to what's in this folder, this just turns this into a low to medium sensitivity probe at absolute best. So when I started putting this thing together, getting back to the original story there, was a while back. And I started building this on a breadboard and then kind of went to dead bug style. And I wanted to save the final design of this when I build the circuit board for a video so I could share that with you guys. And that's what I'm going to do in this video here. So looking at the design of this, it's a relatively simple design, and there's a whole bunch of things that were running through my head when I was putting this thing together. First of all is I'm going to share this design with you guys, as you can see here. So I want to keep the parts as common as possible. So I want to use just, very common parts, and I want to use as many of the pieces over and over again so you don't need to buy a whole bundle of different parts. So to give you an example, all the transistors are all NPN 2N3904s. They're just about as common as dirt, right? You can see I'm reusing the same values, 3.3 meg 15K, 3.3 meg 15K, 3.3 meg, and so on and so forth, all the way through this schematic here. So it really was about a minimalist design. It was about the right balance to make the probe work very well and keep component down. So there's a whole lot of things going through my mind at the time when I was putting this thing together. As you can see, lots of values are repeating all over the place. So how this thing works here, it has two separate functions, really. I'll start just explaining how the front end works here. So we have two common emitter amplifiers here. So at this point here, we have a pretty stout signal with almost nothing here. In fact, this amplifier is so sensitive that it's creating its own noise at this point. Now, you'll see here at the emitter of this transistor, this here is an emitter follower. We can bypass this section here and just go right to another emitter follower that's just basically driving a cable, and that runs down into the amplifier, which I'll explain here in just a little bit. So this is for when the switch is in this mode here, bypassing this one section here. It's basically for sniffing out very, very low-level audio circuits and stuff like that. So if you have a problem in a transistorized audio amplifier, or say there's a very low-level audio signal or even some RF somewhere, and you want to basically sniff out where it's gone missing, this is going to do that very well. Again, this is a non-contact style probe, and this is so sensitive that you can only have just a little bit of the probe end exposed, And by having that probe end exposed, it'll pick up the audio signal in an RCA cable or any kind of audio cable just by holding it close to the end. It really is that sensitive. So very, very sensitive. And when I designed this, I wanted to give it a variable gain so that we can basically turn this probe gain up and down. We can also turn the audio gain up and down in the amplifier. So this is all taken into account when I'm putting this thing together. Now, if we move the switch over into this position right here, what ends up happening is we enable this little circuit here, so it's no longer bypassing this. And this circuit is very sensitive for detecting crackling, popping, and, you know, even mild RF levels, really, is what this is for. So you'll see that there's an adjustment rate down here, which is a 100K potentiometer. Now this is designed to be a set it and forget it kind of control. So this is going to be hiding within the probe. I don't plan on having an external control for this VR. And I'll get into that when I set the whole thing up here in just a little bit after it's all designed. But you'll see that this VR is on the base and there's a 330K resistor above this. Now this is basically a fine adjustment to basically take this transistor and turn it off, make it quiet. So what's happening here is the front end of this is making so much gain. It's basically creating its own static and noise at this point. So by adjusting this, when the switch is in this position here, you're basically pulling this transistor into an off state. So it's kind of squelching the noise in the front end. Now, here's the trick. This is so sensitive that any kind of crackling or popping will create large excursions in the signal, and it'll very easily override this, and it makes a very pronounced clicking and popping noise in the speaker because of the detection in this section here. So it works very well for, you know, finding that just very minute kind of hissing, popping, crackly components like a, you know, bad resistor or capacitor or something like that. This here is just an indicating circuit just to help you realize when you're close to an RF or audio signal, this little LED will light up. And if you're in a crackling or popping circuit, this little LED will, you know, flutter and you know, kind of go on and off with the cracking and popping. So that's just there as an indicator. So that's this circuit here. Now, another thing I kept in mind is that I don't want to basically be running any kind of special cable out of this probe down into the amplifier or power supply unit. I want to just take a standard, you know, balanced audio cable or something like that and use it. So, for example, if you have a piece of audio cable with some XLRs on it, it'll have a red, a white, and a shield inside it. You can just use a piece of cable like that to run from the probe down to the amplifier. So this circuit, when there is no signal and it's just sitting on your bench listening to static, basically just standing there, the thing, this just probe head alone, will draw 780 microamps. So not even a milliamp. When the tip of this is in the presence of a very large signal, so say you bring this close to an oscillator coil or something like that, and this green LED is really bright, this probe draws 2.3 to 2.5 milliamps maximum, which allows me to control the voltage with just a simple VR. So we can adjust the probe voltage supply with just a 2K, you know, standard VR. Half watt VR will be absolutely fine for that. On the wiper, we have a 4.7 microfarad capacitor here just to keep any noise off and all that kind of stuff, you know, from the VR. And, you know, if depending on the length of cable that you're running up there, you know, just to basically keep it clean, that's all. Now, I build this around the parts that I have, and I had a rail full of LM4871s, and I also have a rail of LM4891s. The 4871 is a 3-watt version, so I ended up using that. Very simple circuit to use. The only catch with this is that it needs to be around 5 volts. I'd say 5.5 maximum. So in mine, I plan to use some nickel metal hydride batteries, 4 AA's. So you really don't want to exceed about 5.5 volts with this. If you do, you're going to probably have to run a current limiting resistor in line with this IC, or you might damage it. So that's all in the spec sheet for the LM4871 or like below. Very nice circuit, very simple to hook up, no capacitors in line with the speaker or anything, right out of the IC, right into the speaker. Really nice design, very, you know, minimal amount of components around the IC to make it work. I did add one amplification stage here, and that's just comfortable to basically bring it up to make this thing operate like a normal signal tracer. You know, you'll have ample audio and a volume level with this little amplifier here. In fact, even without the amplifier, if you wanted to eliminate this and, you know, run that in there, it's going to be a little quieter. You won't have the, you know, the range, and it would still work fine. You know, if you come across a strong signal, it's still going to get loud. But this, you know, just allows you to turn the probe gain down and turn the audio gain up. It's basically why I added this here. And when I demonstrate how this thing works, I'll show you exactly how that all functions. So just, you know, this, you can use a 4.7K potentiometer here with this switch over here. This is just a standard, any kind of, you know, potentiometer. If you have a 4.7K potentiometer, use it. If you have a 10K potentiometer to switch on it, use it. It's not really picky. And you can see that one end of the potentiometers is tied right to ground. The other end goes through the white cable and directly up to the emitter up here in the actual probe head itself. So all you're doing is you're bringing the wiper of this transistor here closer to the signal or closer to ground, just to give you your variation in volume level or audio gain level. Now, you see how I have a 10K resistor here in the probe with a star beside it? If you wanted to use this with a standard signal tracer, you can do that. Just put a 10K resistor up here in the probe, and then you just have audio running out of this. And usually most signal tracers like ICOs and Heathkits and Nightkits, they all have a blocking capacitor right at the jack. So that blocking capacitor would block any DC from going into the machine at that point. So that would be absolutely fine. If there is no blocking capacitor on the input of your signal tracer, you would need to add one. That's basically what this is here. This 4.7 microfarad capacitor is just basically isolating this section from the VR. If not, when you move the VR around, it would affect the bias of the transistor and all sorts of things, right? So that's how that works there. And I think that's pretty much all for this little section here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start laying this out on the computer. I'll start drawing up a little circuit board here. Oh yeah, I was going to show you the probe shell. The probe shell is just like the other Heathkit probe shell, except this one here has a switch on it. So I can mount this switch here right in this area here. Now this is just a standard old Heathkit probe. I've hollowed it out already. This unit is so sensitive that it has to be in a metal probe shell. You can't have this in a plastic probe shell. It'll have to be shielded. Now, if you're uncomfortable with holding a metal probe shell when you're working on any kind of electronic stuff, you can insulate this entire shell by putting some heat shrink on it or doing something like that. That safety aspect is up to you, whatever you feel comfortable with. So Heathkit made these things to be held like this at the time. Again, a lot of people are uncomfortable with that, especially if you're working around high voltage circuitry. So you want to keep that in mind. You may want to insulate this. Again, you need to know what your application is and what you're comfortable with. So if you're building anything with a probe shell that's got exposed metal, keep that in mind. If you come across anything high voltage, you'll know about it. So yeah, if you're building this, you're definitely doing so at your own risk. Take care, especially with a shell like this. Now for my own use, this is my own personal use, I'm going to leave this exposed. Because the circuits that I'm in and the way that I do things, I'm not really too incredibly concerned about that. Again, the safety aspect is up to you. Handy probe shells, you can find these things down at, you know, just ham swaps, attached to old Heathkit signal tracers and things like that. Very, very handy probe shell. In fact, I have a really neat idea for another probe shell that uses some modern stuff. And I'll get into that here when I design another probe. So it involves a vacuum desoldering pump. So at any rate, I'll save that for that particular video. So at any rate, I'll get started on the layout here. And once I get the layout done, we'll talk about that. And I'll start designing this thing here and find a speaker and figure out what kind of a project box or whatever I'm going to put this thing into. We'll cross that bridge when we get there. This is the circuit board layout that I've come up with for this probe project. So what you see on the screen will fit inside that probe shell. This has nothing to do with the amplifier yet at this point. Now, what is on the screen is enlarged quite a bit so that we can take a look at it. The real size of this board is right about there. And that's even larger than the original little board that was in that probe to begin with. Now, they had a small circuit board inside the probe that kind of held some through-hole parts. You would just twist them together through holes and stuff. This is the little board right here. And you can see that there's three little slots right here. The switch would fit into that. And then you would, you know, put a diode or a resistor through these holes, twist things together and solder it. And this could be used as a coax strain relief and stuff like that, right? Now, the probe ends, the red and black probe ends, We're actually quite a ways away from this, so there's a bit of room on each side, so I wanted to optimize on that. So I measured the distance between the actual probe, and I could make the circuit board a little bit bigger, so you can see that the board itself is just a little bit bigger than the original board. Now, I'll just enlarge this again. So the switch won't fit here. I don't have provisions to, you know, basically cut a little slot here, so I'll just drill the holes. It's large pads, and the switch should fit right in there. Now, another thing about prototyping boards like this is the plated through holes. For all of your vias, you have to put a wire through and solder it on both sides of the board, and that's what all these little red dots are here. They're all little vias to the other side of the board. Now, you can see that the green side here is going to be the top side. The black side is going to be the bottom. So that'll be a ground plane layer or a common layer in this probe to just create some shielding. I wanted as much of that as I could get on here. So you can see that these traces are on the upper side of the board, and when I sit the switch down onto this board, I'm going to have to elevate the switch just a little bit so I can get a soldering iron under the switch to solder these pads here. Reason being is because there is no basically plated through hole between this. So if I solder the bottom side of the board, nothing will creep up to the top side and connect this to the switch, so I'll have open connections. So again, that's what happens when you prototype like this. So normally in a case like this, if I had more room, what I would do is I just put, you know, say three vias here, bring the connections to the bottom side of the board out of the way of the switch, and then just solder them on the bottom side. But you can see everything's pretty tight here. So I'll just elevate this, use a thinner tip on my soldering iron, and just kind of get under the switch and solder them on the upper side and then on the bottom side. Not too big of a deal. If you're making single-sided boards, absolutely fine. And if these are exposed in an open area, putting a piece of wire through is fine. The size of the vias here is the hole size, roughly 0.018, something like that. The wire diameter will be around that as well. So you don't want the holes to be too big so that the wires kind of flop around in there. You kind of want to almost feed them through so that they're tight. So when you solder them on one side, when you go to solder them on the other side, you don't pull it through because it very quickly melts the solder. And depending on the thickness of your circuit board, you know, that's could be a pretty fast process. Now, I'm going to be using very thin circuit board for this just because I want to fit this all in the probe shell, and I'm going to have to elevate this switch up too. So if I elevate the switch, it's going to put the circuit board lower, and I have to slide this inside that aluminum tube. So you'll see what you'll see about all my plans and stuff when I put this whole thing together here. So a lot of measuring and stuff went into putting this thing together. So this is where the tip is going to be. So this will extend out to the tip. Now, I plan on using a piece of coax for the tip and just expose a very small piece of that coax to basically act as the sniffer at the end of the tip there. This is the first common emitter amplifier here, and basically the signal carries through and goes into here, and it works its way around through this entire circuit. This right here is that 100K variable potentiometer or potentiometer. Now, if you're going to build this thing, you don't need to build it like this. If it's going to be in an entirely shielded shell like this Heathkit probe, you could put this thing together dead bug style, or, you know, something like that. Just glue TO92 components together and use standard through-hole parts, and it would be absolutely fine. Again, it needs to be in a completely shielded shell because this thing is so sensitive. And, you know, if you wanted to figure out the VR settings, find an area that's comfortable by, you know, playing with some resistor values. Once you figure it out, just, you don't need to use a VR. You can just put a couple of resistors together and, you know, just do it like that. So you don't even need to have a VR in there. Again, you know, this here for me is a set it and forget it kind of thing. And, you know, again, this is going to be a pretty small layout. Again, everything is kind of optimized here. So I want to see what this thing is going to perform like on a circuit board. It worked out quite well on the breadboard with all the stuff exposed and a fence around it. So I'm expecting some pretty good results here. So that's pretty much it. So the black layer that you see is on the back side of the board here. So that's it's the solid copper on the back side. And you can see the upper traces on the top side of the board are completely shielded at that point. So basically all of these vias that you see here are just grounding to the other side of the circuit board. So it's just carrying through, and the back side of the circuit board will act as a ground, instead of, you know, having to run ground wires to, you know, all over the place. Makes things a little bit easier. These here are the lead-ins. This here is the positive supply. There's a 4.7 microfarad capacitor here. This here is the audio. So the audio will come out here, and you'll just solder the shield to this portion of the circuit board here, the backside of the board. You can see that runs up over here to this via, carries up to the top side of the board here, and then goes on to the appropriate components. Now, the part size that I'm using for most of this is 0402, so it's very small stuff. Putting 0402 stuff together on a circuit board without a microscope is, rather difficult. Again, as you can see the board, I've pretty much used up all the upper space on the board. It's a pretty tight fit with all of the traces and everything. Now, if I wanted to use the back side of the circuit board to populate that, I'd have a lot more room over there and I could, extend things, but I want to keep the back side a solid shield pretty much for the entire circuit board here. So again, when I run the piece of coax out of this end here to the actual tip, so the coax would extend out this way and I'd have just a little bared end over here. The shield of the coax will just solder to the bottom side of the circuit board and the center conductor will solder to this pad right here. And that'll carry the signal right into here. These are tantalum capacitors and just 0402. All these little pads you see are all 0402 resistors and capacitors and things like that. So what I'll do is I'll get this thing all put together. Well, actually, I'll etch off the board first and then I'll put it together. I'll show you what the board looks like when it's etched. And then I'll populate it. The circuit board is etched, plated, drilled, and ready to populate at this point. So this is where the switch is going to mount over here. You can see I'm using some pretty thin circuit board. Even the original is quite a bit thicker. So that's the upper side, and this is the bottom side. You can see all the little holes here. That's basically just carrying those vias from the top side to the bottom side, and I'll just solder them there and it'll act as a nice ground plane. So this is where the wires will come in over here, and I'll just use this little corner here to solder the shield on. I got to be careful I don't get solder very close to the edge here because I'm pretty sure the clearances are going to be pretty tight when I put this in that probe shell. So that's what the board looks like just before it's populated. I notice that if I move this thing certain ways under this light here, the traces seem to get wide. It looks like the traces are wider than they are. I guess it's just the light shining off the tin surface. The circuit board is populated now and pretty much ready to install into the probe shell. So you can see I've mounted the LED on a little wire here. Basically, this is going to allow me to place the LED in an area that I can see it. And I figure that the only place that I'm going to be able to mount this is in this end cap here where the wires come out. So there's enough room in there that I can drill a hole on an angle in this end cap here and then have the LED point out kind of at me on an angle. The reason I want this to point directly at me because in a case of, some very, very light scratching and, very intermittent kind of noise, this is going to flutter a very light green color. It's not going to be super, super bright. The stronger the signal, the brighter the LED. And if it's, pointed off on an angle like this, you're not going to see it very well. You kind of really want this to be pointed right at you when you're searching for noise. So I'll probably have this in line with this switch here. So when I'm holding the actual probe, the switch will be, on the top side. And this will be just in line with that. So I'll see how that all works out here in the end. This is the actual probe tip. So this is a shielded piece of coax here, and this is the only area that's open here that's going to be doing any kind of sniffing. Now, there's no way that you could run this exposed all the way to that end. The probe would be completely unusable. It would pick up so much noise from, just surrounding things like, switch mode power supplies, and it would pick up hum and probably your soldering iron power supply on the workbench and all sorts of things. So it needs to be completely shielded. Now the actual probe shell itself extends a little further than the circuit board, so this little exposed area here is absolutely fine. So for any experimentation that you're going to do with something like this, you could expose a piece of wire the same length as this just beyond the probe shell here. And then that would be used for, sniffing and experimenting with this. If you were to extend this for, say, a centimeter or two beyond this probe shell, again, the board would be so noisy, this would be so noisy, it would be completely unusable at that point. So you can see that there's still a little bit of room on each side here, and that room needs to be there because the probe ends have this little area right here that slides into the aluminum like that. So it pretty much, it uses up the rest of the space. There's just a little bit left on each side for some movement here. What holds this entire board and everything steady is the two screws on the switch here, so that'll hold everything steady. Now there's quite a bit of measurement in getting this just right to fit in this shell here, just because I had to elevate the switch a little bit so that I could solder these connections here on the bottom side. So get my flashlight here and show you those connections there. Soldered quite easily. I really cleaned the leads of the switch very well and pre-tinned them before I put them in the board here. Put a little bit of RA type flux under there and, you know, just basically touched them and it was soldered. And then I soldered the bottom portion of the board here as well. So on the bottom portion of the board here, you'll notice that there's a braid, and this braid is to ground this ground layer to the shell of the probe, which is, you know, this shell right here. If the shell isn't grounded, it's just going to make so much noise from your hand holding it, it would be absolutely crazy and make this unusable again. So the actual switch itself is not grounded, the metal surface of the switch, so screwing this switch to the shell will ground this portion of the switch, and there's only one ground lead that's connected to the actual shell, so this whole area will end up being shielded and grounded. Very important in this application. Again, absolutely no plastic, solid plastic probe shells. If you want to use a plastic probe shell, you're going to have to coat the inside of it with some sort of a, you know, spray-on conductive coating or something like that. Again, it'll be completely unusable unless this is entirely shielded. So that's how that is all set up. So what I'm going to do now is solder on some wires here and get this thing all ready to go. And I'm going to start designing the amplifier portion so that I can get the, you know, basically test this thing out. I could feed this thing into the amplifier on my breadboard and, you know, we could do some experimentation there. But what I'll do is I'll build the amplifier first, get that all set up, and then I'll work on getting this thing all finalized. I'm ready to design the audio amplifier circuit board for this signal tracer project. So take what you see here and put it onto a small board. But before I do that, I really need to figure out what kind of an enclosure I'm going to put this thing into, so, you know, I cut the board to the right size so everything will fit. So I have the board itself, two VRs, an audio input jack, and a battery pack to fit into some enclosure or speaker box. So I was looking around through my stuff and I remembered I had this old communication speaker packed away. It's an old realistic SP150. I think this was the companion speaker for the DX160, maybe some other realistic receivers. At any rate, it's in really nice condition, and this would make a nice little amplified speaker for the signal tracer. So the back side of the box, I've got the rear cover removed on the back side here. Somebody had put a huge block of foam in there, and I wanted to see what was all inside here. So it looks pretty good. It's nice and clean. So I'm thinking to myself, how am I going to, you know, mount all the controls on the box here? Do I really want to, you know, mount the, you know, the probe gain, the audio gain, and audio input jack, and all that kind of stuff on the box here? And I'm going to have to drill some holes in, and they're not going to face me, and it's not going to look all that good if I have them on the side here. Say I've got, you know, two knobs here in the audio input jack, right? So three holes, it's not going to look very good. So I'm looking at the face of the unit here, and there's quite a distance between this and the actual speaker itself, about that much. So I'm thinking, hey, I can clean the writing off. Maybe I can put the VRs here and, you know, have the input jack here. But you know what? They glued this thing together like crazy. Look at that. So getting this thing apart, you know, I'm going to probably damage the grill, and I really don't want to do that. It looks like it already has maybe just a very slight dent here already. See that? Other than that, you know, it's in really nice condition, so I don't want to damage this. So I'd like to have the controls facing me, right? So I picked up this Hammond box, and I figure I'm just going to mount it to the top of the unit like this. I'll put the controls on the front side of the Hammond box, paint the box up, and fit everything inside here. So another thing is, how am I going to mount this to the top here? Because I want this just to be one unit. I don't want to have, you know, separate amplifier, separate speaker, and all that kind of stuff. I just want to, you know, grab the unit when I need it and use it. So look on the bottom here, and you can see these threaded holes here. That's how they mount the bottom cover onto this box. It comes with a bottom cover. So I could take that bottom cover, lay it on the top here, and then, you know, size up the holes. But another problem is that if I drill holes here, it's going to, you know, go right into the grill in the front, right? I don't want to do that. It's too close to the speaker at any rate. And it make it, you know, really hard to get apart if I need to change batteries or something like that. So I figure I'll mount the battery pack inside here. So it'll be a, you know, a plastic battery holder with, you know, four AA nickel metal hydrides in there. And then what I'll do is I'll, you know, measure just in front of that battery pack, maybe drill a hole here and one hole into the top of the box here, and I'll thread it. And what I'll basically do then is put a large screw in the top, and then when I tighten this down, it'll just basically pull this down against the top side of the speaker box. There's enough surface area on the bottom side of this box that, you know, it's not going to move around or anything like that. It'll hold it nice and steady, and it's only one screw to take off to, you know, change the batteries or charge them or however I figure I'm, you know, going to set that all up. So that's what I'm going to do. I'll size everything up and, you know, figure out how I'm going to mount the VRs and the audio input jack on here. Probably paint the box and get all of that underway, and then I'll start designing that audio amplifier circuit board when I know exactly how it's going to fit in here. Before I start designing the audio circuit board for this project, I figured I'd do some measurement, drill some holes here, and get the box painted up. And then that way, while the box is drying the paint on the box, I can be working on the circuit board. Well, it just turns out that this stuff dried really quickly, and I can pretty much handle it right now. So what I've done here is I've painted the box in off-white color, and you'll see why I've done that here in just a little bit. And I've got all the holes drilled all over this thing for all the different jacks. So this jack here will be where the 2K potentiometer goes for the probe gain. LED will fit in there just for an on light. This is the audio gain and on and off. VR will go in here. Right here will be the probe input, so I think I'm going to use a quarter inch stereo headphone jack for that. That should work just fine. And on the back, there's a hole drilled for a speaker jack. Now, I don't really have the heart to drill a hole in the top of that little communication speaker because it's just in such good condition. So I think what I'll do is I'll probably just put the bottom on this and put some feet on it or something like that. Or maybe even some Velcro and just stick it to the top of the box there. Really, it is in such good condition, it would be a shame to put a hole in the top of it. So that's fine. This here can be a separate unit. No problems with that whatsoever. So I'll let this just set up a little bit more. It's, you know, pretty good to handle at this point here, but again, I'll let it set up for a while and I'll get back to the audio amplifier circuit board. This is the circuit board layout that I've come up with for the audio amplifier portion of this project. I didn't know what to call the project, so I just called it Super Probe. So all these pads that you see around the perimeter of the board here all go to somewhere in that project box. So these three pads here run off to the stereo quarter inch headphone jack that will bring the power to the probe and the signal back to this audio amplifier circuit board. These three pads that you see here are the probe gain control, so these will just run right off to that VR. Same with these here, these ones here are for the audio gain control, again will run off to that VR, 4.7K and a 2K potentiometer. This is the power for the circuit board here, so this is the ground, and this is the positive 5 volts, or, you know, a little bit over 5 volts is fine. And this will run out to the speaker jack right here. This is a little audio IC here, and just, you know, associated components. This is a little transistor here and some tantalum capacitors, and the rest of the capacitors are ceramic style. These are some 0-ohm jumpers here, and a 4.7 mic ceramic capacitor, and so on and so forth. So all the little, you know, 0402 components and everything that make this work. So the real size of the board is that big right there. So the way I'm displaying it here is so that I can easily work on it, that's all. So what I'm going to do now is print this off and put it onto a piece of circuit board and etch it and do all that kind of stuff. And once I've got that all done, we'll take a look at the etched circuit board. The circuit board is now etched and plated, and I'm pretty much ready to populate this. So what I'm going to do is put some components on this, and I'll be right back. Here's the audio amplifier board, fully populated and ready to install in that project box. I'm ready to install the components in the box now, so the paint and the clear coat are now dry. Marie, my other half, she designed up the artwork for the box, and I think she did a fantastic job. I took that artwork, put it onto a clear shipping label, cut the clear shipping label to size, and put it on the box, and then put a coat of clear over top of it. It's actually an acrylic enamel. So that worked out quite well. I also did that with the labeling for the controls and the jacks as well. So when I have all the components installed in the box and the things ready to test out, I'll be back. The probe audio amplifier is complete, and it went together pretty quick. So when I was installing the battery pack and the circuit board, I didn't want to drill any more holes in the box because, well, the artwork's already on top and it's done and, you know, the box is painted. So what I did is I just used industrial strength super glue and just went in a zigzag pattern on the bottom portion of the battery holder here. And when I say industrial strength super glue, this stuff does not fool around. I've got one chance and one chance only to get everything straight. So I measured everything up and just dropped it in nice and straight, pressed the battery holder in, and at that point it's one with the box. It's not coming out again. It's the same thing with the circuit board as well. There's a little dot of super glue under the circuit board holding it in place. Everything was pre-measured. That worked out very nice. Didn't have to drill any extra holes. I kind of want to keep, you know, the holes down to a minimum. Keeps the box clean looking. So no extra holes other than what you've seen. So this is the jack that'll supply power to the probe. And it'll also, the audio will come back in here. This is the probe sensitivity VR. This is the audio gain VR. And this is the switch for the whole unit right here. And this is the audio output jack on the back side of the box. So when the switch is on, it's basically taking everything that the batteries can supply and putting it across this VR right here. The wiper of the VR goes out to the actual probe. So if the cable was to ever short, or say the, you know, the probe shorted, or say something accidentally got plugged into here that wasn't supposed to be in here, if I advance this potentiometer to its maximum position, the potentiometer would emit maximum smoke if it was, you know, if the jack was shorted, right? So I definitely don't want that to happen. So what I've done is I've installed a small light bulb in series with the wiper. And that's basically in series with this jack here. So the light bulb itself is a 6 volt, 32 milliamp light bulb. So its cold resistance in the circuit here is 16 ohms. So the probe itself only draws, what, 2.3, 2.5 milliamps maximum. And that's under, you know, a super, super strong signal, right? So it won't even know that this light bulb is here. But if something ever gets shorted, it'll save the VR and I won't have to worry about repairing anything in the box. So basically, it's just acting as a current limiter. So, in fact, I can probably actually show you this thing here. I'll grab this here. The cable's just sitting off to the side. Plug it in here, and I'll turn this on. And I'll advance this to, there we go. It's full position. Okay, so I'll touch the, I'll short the leads out. So these are the leads right here. This is the audio lead right here. This is ground, and this is the positive. I don't know if you can see that there. So that's the positive that'll run to the probe. So what I'll do is I'll just short the positive and you'll see the little light bulb in here light up. So I'll just do that right. Just keep an eye on the bulb there. There we go. See, now if I was to do that and that little bulb wasn't there, that VR would be letting off the magic smoke right now. And as you can see, if I turn the VR, it just comfortably turns the light. Oh, that's me not pinching the light tight enough, or the wires tight enough. So as I turn the VR up and down, as you can see, it just basically varies the intensity of the light bulb, not hurting the VR whatsoever, and just protecting the entire circuit. So that's all ready to go. So everything is working. It's ready to be basically put together, and I can finish off the probe. So that's what I'm going to do. I'll put the bottom cover on this thing and get this out of the way. And then I'll attach these wires here to the probe and get everything with the probe all hooked up, and then we'll try the whole thing out. I'm ready to start assembling the probe. So the very first thing I'm going to do is put the LED in this end cap here. So what I've done is I've drilled a hole here in the cap on a pretty tight angle. And that way the LED will somewhat face me when I'm holding this. So you can get an idea of the angle right there. That's a pretty tight angle. So this is gonna sit in the end of the probe like this. And when I'm holding this, it'll pretty much aim the LED right at me. So I can use that as a visual indication. So the LED has to go in first, and then after that I'll feed this wire in, this bare end here, through this, and I'll solder it up to the board. And at that point I can kind of just slide the whole thing into this aluminum tube here, and then in the very end this little cap just goes on the end, so this very easily just slides over the coax. So I'll start getting this all put together here, and then I'll show how that little adjustment works on the board as well. I'm ready to make adjustments to the VR on the probe board now. That's that little VR right there. But just before I do, I'll explain exactly how I have everything all hooked up here. So first of all, the probe board is recessed a ways down into, or set a ways down into, this drill vise here. The drill vise is just holding the board steady so I can make the adjustment. And the reason it's recessed is because this is grounded to the drill vise through this braided strap, so it needs to act as shielding. And by recessing the board, it acts as more of a shield than having it sitting right at the top of the drill vise. And it's working quite well. It's keeping it nice and quiet. This lid that you see over here is grounded to the drill vise through this little jumper cable here, and that's just to stop the probe from picking up noise from this direction. If I remove the lid from this direction, it'll pick up buzzing and humming from, you know, other things that are on AC over here, and I have a couple of switch mode power supplies close by, so it really is that sensitive. So this is just acting as a shield over here, and I'll demonstrate that here in just a little bit. This alligator clip here is holding this cable in position so that you can see the little indicator LED. And this is the screwdriver I'll be using to tune the little VR in there. And this is the probe amplifier that you saw in the recent shot. So the probe itself right now is in the audio mode. So right now the probe would be used for tracing down a problem in an audio section. Say you have a guitar amplifier or a hi-fi amplifier with a dead section in it or something like that. Say, you know, one section has gotten weak and you want to find where the audio has gone missing or, you know, something like that. It can be used for multiple other uses as well, but that's its primal intention, is really to search for missing audio and in circuits like that. It can also be used to locate oscillators and things like that as well, but I'll get into that again later. So in this mode here, it would be technically listening for that. So what I'll do is I'll turn on the probe amplifier right now and I'll just turn it up to say 10 o'clock. That's 10 o'clock right there. You can hear how loud it is. If I turn it up to 12 o'clock, right, lots of audio gain. So the reason it has so much audio gain is that if you want to reduce the probe gain itself, you might want to advance the audio gain. It just depends on how you're using this to troubleshoot. So, put it back to about 10 o'clock there. So now to give you an idea of how sensitive this is, I'll take the screwdriver. Now keep in mind that this lid here is grounded out. This is grounded right now, and I'll drag this screwdriver along the lid and it'll listen to me dragging this screwdriver. So it's gonna hear my hand basically dragging the screwdriver across this. I'll be acting as the antenna, I guess you could say. Now keep in mind that this is in audio mode. This is not in noise mode, okay? So here I go. You see the LED flickering there? So I'll get that a little bit more in focus. There we go. So you can see how incredibly sensitive that is in audio mode. Now just say that you had, let's turn this down for a sec. Now just say that you had a crackly component like a capacitor or say a noisy resistor or say a tube was arcing out in its socket or something like that. Say a tube pin wasn't making contact with the connector quite right, and it was, you know, kind of buzzing and hissing in there. That's what this would be used for. So I'll turn this back up to 10 o'clock again. I'll click the switch into noise mode here. Okay, so right now it's in noise mode. Now listen to what happens when I do the exact same thing. See how it's detecting that noise now? So very useful for finding noise. Quite a difference from, say, just the see the difference from just the audio mode. Now here's where the magic of that little VR comes into play. So I'm going to turn the probe gain down until this gets quiet. That's this section working now. Okay, so it's pretty quiet there. I'll turn the audio up just a little bit. You can hear how it's still just quiet, very quiet. Now watch what happens when I touch the screwdriver to the lid. See how sensitive that is? That's only at, what, 11 o'clock? And that's with the probe gain reduced. So this thing is going to listen for any kind of static or crackling or hissing or intermittent noises. That's exactly what this is designed to do. It's designed to detect that. And that little VR is basically just to set where it gets quiet at on the probe gain control. So you can see here that I want it set so that I can tell the difference just by moving the switch around. So if I leave that there, turn the probe gain up, and say I click it back into the audio mode, you can hear the difference in static. All right. Hear the difference? I want it set like that. So that way, if I'm moving the probe switch around, I can really tell the difference. All right, so this is all just personal preference. So it's in the noise mode now, and you can see that I have this at maximum gain. So if I adjust that probe, that's me getting close to the probe. So if I adjust this VR right now, see how sensitive that is? So I've now made this way more sensitive to noise as well. So it's a fine balance. It all really depends on where you want this. So I'll turn the gain down and you can see. You see, so now I have to turn it down just a little bit more to make it quiet. And you can see that now, you can see that the audio mode is actually getting a little bit quieter because the gain, right? Watch this. See, it almost enhances it a bit. So the whole idea is to have this section quieter so that you can really just, you know, kind of get rid of that hiss. And that's really what that's for. So the way I had it before was a fine balance. And I can actually remember the position where the VR was in, right about there. So I'll have to fine tune that just to get it exactly where I wanted it. But so you can tell now. Now when I turn this again back into the audio mode, the audio will be louder. See that? And the noise mode is just a little bit more quiet. So that's what that does. That's how this whole thing works. So what I'll do is I'll get this probe all put together now in its housing and everything. And I'll try and get some mock circuits together here so that I can demonstrate how the probe actually works in real life. Here's an example of the Super Probe looking for a noisy component or components. Now these components could be in any piece of gear, television, radio, receiver, audio amplifier, piece of test gear, anything like that, anything with components in it. So the noisy components here or component are these right here. Now this is out of Hammarlund HQ140X receiver, and that's in the previous video. If you're interested in that troubleshooting procedure where I originally found these with a different signal tracer and a different probe, I'll put that into the Show More tab just below. I'll start the video off at the point where I'm troubleshooting these because the video itself is about 3 hours long. So I think the troubleshooting procedure started about 3/4 of the way through the video is when I encountered this issue. So I'll just start it at that point. If you're interested in that, check it out. Now, this probe here is much, much more sensitive than that particular probe. And that's the reason that I spent the time on this. So this is really designed to just narrow in on noise, and that's what I'm going to demonstrate here quite shortly. So this is kind of a real world condition. This really is a noisy component. I'm not sure whether it's the resistor or the capacitor at this point. I don't want to separate them to find out which one it is, because if I do, it might not be noisy anymore. So it makes a great test fixture. Again, this is considered to be a non-contact style probe. You can see I've added some heat shrink tubing over the end here to isolate the end of the probe so that I can't touch this into circuit at all. It keeps this completely isolated. The probe shell itself is exposed metal. If you're uncomfortable with holding this, put some insulation over top of it. That's just the way they came from Heathkit at the time. So if you're working on any kind of high voltage circuitry or anything with a probe shell like this, I really strongly suggest that you do insulate it. Just be safe. So I'll turn the power supply on and hopefully this will act up. So here we go. I'll turn on the probe. Now this is just noise because this isn't in a chassis right now. If you had a chassis and this was, you know, you were looking around in a chassis, the chassis acts as a shield so it would keep this quiet. This is just kind of pointing into nowhere. So it's in the noise mode. Let's see if it's making any kind of noise. It is. And it's picking it up quite well. So I'll turn the probe gain down, and you'll see how it just kind of narrows into just that cracking and popping noise. Turn the volume up. Now in the audio mode, it won't see this as well. You can see that in the audio mode. Right now it's designed to look for a dead audio stage, so you would hear audio clearly through the probe. You can still hear it because it's so aggressive, but in the actual noise mode, you can hear how it just focuses on the noise. In situations where the noise is a little bit lighter than this, if you had it in the audio mode, you would just see the light flicker and you really won't hear the noise all that well. So you can see how the LED is a nice little feature to have as an indicator there as well. That's a very noisy component right now. It's very intermittent. I can turn this on and it won't make noise for 5 minutes and all of a sudden it will, so this is actually working very well for the demonstration right now. You can see how far I can get away from the actual component. It's still listening to it. I'm about 2 inches away right now, inches wise. It's about 3 inches. And I'm getting out of the range. It's about 4 inches maybe there. So just to show you that it is the component making the noise, I'll shut the power supply off. Okay, power supply's off, and power supply's back on again. You see where the audio is, lots of range. So a very, very useful feature. So next, we'll search for some audio. Let's listen to all the strange noises that come out of an old Discman. These are all the noises that you wouldn't want to hear. So, I'll turn this on here and I'll just hold on to the common because there's nothing for me to really ground this to because it's a completely isolated unit. So it's in the audio mode. Turn this on. So hopefully I can get this into the shot here okay. So I'll bring this just close to the audio jack here. You can see how useful that would be to track down a weak audio stage. Very, very sensitive. Now if we want to hear all the wonderful digital noises going on in here, we'll put it into the detection mode. It's right around the display. If we have that in the audio mode, you can see it doesn't really listen to it. So this is right around the volume control area. So all the things going on inside a Discman that you never really wanted to hear. Lots of little active circuits all over the place in there. Let's take a listen in this old little Super Heterodyne radio. And when I say little, it's a pretty small little radio. They crammed a lot of tubes in this box. It gets pretty hot. So I'll just get this out of the case and we'll take a listen around inside that. This is the inside of this little radio. This is known as an All-American 5, AA5, or if you prefer, you can just call it a transformerless set. Now, the reason they call these things transformerless sets is because they've eliminated the power transformer out of the design in order to make the chassis smaller, to make the entire radio smaller, and to cut costs, make these things more affordable. And this goes, you know, way back, right into the Octal series of tubes and even before. Before that, they even had the line cords were acting as basically part of the filament string. It was a resistor. The line cord itself was known as a curtain burner. That's another story for the future. So this isn't a curtain burner. This is just a standard line cord here. Now the catch is, if you work on any of these older receivers, you need to know that you need an isolation transformer between this and the wall. Reason being is because one side of the line cord is attached directly to the chassis, and the plug at the end of this line cord is not polarized. So you can plug it in this way, or you can plug it in this way. So you have a 50-50 chance of making the chassis of this older receiver hot. And that's why these older receivers, and even older ones than this that are Bakelite, have all plastic knobs with no set screws, and the case is solid plastic. So you can't come in contact with any metal when you're, you know, fiddling with the knobs and dials on the face of it. And if this was older, it would be Bakelite and so on and so forth. So, very important, you have to have an isolation transformer. If you don't, there's a really, really high shock risk. And there still is a high shock risk even with an isolation transformer because there's high voltage in these things. So just keep that in mind. If you're new to All-American 5 designs or anything like this, I strongly suggest you look into them before you do any kind of work on an older receiver like this. So if you're following along, again, you're doing so at your own risk. Just take care. So what we're going to do is use the probe to see if this receiver is working. So what I'll do is I'll turn the probe on. I'll attach this to the chassis here. Now, in order to see if the entire IF chain rate to the detector is working, I'm going to leave this in the detection mode, and I'm just going to bring this close to the detector tube, and we should hear a radio station in there if it's working. So we've just verified that the oscillator in IF section is working right up to the detector tube, just that easy with this probe. Now here's another little trick. If you want to see if the oscillator is working in this receiver, it's just this simple. The oscillator tube is usually, I'd say 99% of the time, closest to the tuning capacitor. So just quickly, the tube lineup in this is a 35W4. That's a half-wave rectifier tube. So that's taking the line and it's rectifying it. So there is no step-up transformer or anything like that. It's just half-wave rectified mains. This is the filter capacitor over here. This is a 50C5. This is the audio output that drives this audio transformer right here. This is a 12AV6. That's a triode and two diodes. So it's technically, you could look at that as two or three tubes in one, really. So it's a detector and an audio amplifier. So that's the audio amplifier for this tube and the detector for this. This is a 12BA6. That's an IF amplifier. And this is a 12BE6. That's a mixer and an oscillator tube. And that's the entire lineup here. That's a really common tube lineup for an All-American 5 receiver. They also make AA6s as well, and they put one RF amplifier in front of this. So this is just the AA5. So this is the oscillator section over here, and if we want to verify if that's working, it's very simple with this probe. Leave this in the detection mode. One portion of the oscillator is attached directly to this capacitor here. So if we get close to this, you'll see the LED glow brightly, and you'll see that this will just get silent. So here we go. See how bright that is? We've just verified that the oscillator is working, just that easy. And there's so many more uses for this probe, I could keep going all day with this. So there you have it. Thanks for stopping by the lab today. Hope you enjoyed this video involving these probes. If you did, I have many more videos coming like this in the near future. In fact, I've designed so many devices in the past, I have books full of schematics and stuff from end to end, and I plan on sharing that all with you guys as time permits. So basically, vacuum tube stuff, solid state stuff, audio circuitry and RF circuitry, even some very interesting high voltage RF circuitry that I think you guys will find pretty intriguing. And all the stuff in the book is documented and tried, tested, and true, so the stuff that I show you is working projects. At any rate, I'll share all the schematics and everything with you guys here in the near future. So if you're into that and you enjoyed this video, you can let me know by giving me a thumbs up and hang around. There'll be much more coming in the near future. Take care, guys. Bye for now.